Chapter 21. Dan reached for the headache tablets through the slits of his eyes, ignored the flashing, stabbing daggers that split his vision, made a guess at the size of his hangover, and popped four from their plastic wrapping. Champagne, cocktails, beer and whiskey, a toxic combination. Four seemed about right. He gulped them down with some water, concentrated on not retching, and closed his eyes again. He woke again a couple of hours later with Rutherford's insistent wet nose in his face. This time, opening his eyes wasn't the cue for fireworks to begin their flashing and crashing in his brain. He waited tentatively for a wave of engulfing sickness. Nothing came. Encouraging. He swung himself out of bed and was relieved to find no sweats, shivers or shakes. In fact, he felt remarkably well. Good stuff, those tablets. He'd have to remember them. "Toilet time, hound?" he rasped, in a voice he only barely recognised. It was amazing how a night of drinking could turn you into a soul singer. Rutherford yelped, and Dan opened the front door, watched the dogs scuttle around the corner of the flat and down to the garden. The gust of cool air from the outside world tasted fresh and rejuvenating. It had been a fine night. El was true to his word and paid for everything, even that ill-advised decision to go to the Moorings Club to do some dancing. He should have known better. When he thought he could dance, it was definitely time to go home. The only disappointment was not seeing Claire, but then, given the state he was in, that was probably for the best. He wouldn't exactly have made a good impression on a sober woman, more likely blown it in a new record time. She'd been kind enough to text him to say work had kept her late, and he'd no doubt soon find out why. Some other time, she hoped. There was another kiss, too. He'd saved the message, kept looking at it throughout the night. What did that mean about finding out why she'd been busy? She was working on the rapist case, he knew that. Some developments? He sensed a story, but then it was the weekend and he wasn't feeling up to investigating. Not yet, anyway. He'd call Adam later to see what was going on. Work could look after itself for a while. It had had its pound of flesh, more like a whole limb, in fact, for the week. There was a stale smell of meat in the flat, so he checked the kitchen. Ah, yes, the familiar remains of a kebab. How delightfully predictable. He tasted the chilli sauce and flinched, then quickly downed a glass of water. Good job he had the benefit of numbing drunkenness, or his taste buds would have melted. There was a note in the kitchen, too, in very bad handwriting. Puzzled, he leaned over to check who'd been in the flat. It took a good few seconds before he recognised the writing as his own. "Dear handsome fella," it read, "I thought I'd better remind you about Plymouth Plymouth and number 225, as El said, because you've been drinking and you won't remember in the morning otherwise, you pissed idiot. Go get that picture, big boy. Love, your biggest fan, Dan. P.S. You dance shite." He leaned back against the cool white of the fridge freezer and shook his head. What went on in his mind was enough of a mystery when he was sober. Drunk, it was even worse, and it seemed to be deteriorating. He couldn't remember ever leaving notes for himself before. A scrabbling at the front door interrupted his musings, and he let Rutherford back in. The dog looked meaningfully at the cupboard where his lead was kept and sat down in front of it. As subtle as his master, that dog. "Okay, mate, I get the hint. No decent walks for a while. We'll go in a minute. I could do with clearing my head." He looked at the note again. What rubbish was he talking anyway? Plymouth, Plymouth and 225. Then it came back to him, El's guess at a possible solution to the death pictures riddle. He felt the familiar, creeping excitement branching out through his body. His hangover forgotten, he rummaged through his bookshelves and found the A to Z of Plymouth. There it was, Plymouth Street, a couple of miles away, down towards the embankment. "Come on, dog, we're off for a new run," Dan rasped. "Call it a journey of discovery. Hopefully, anyway." It was a horribly tough call, but he'd made it, and he knew it was right. Now, though, now the guilt was burning, and he wondered how much damage he'd done, but he had to be there to interview Godley, he had to. "Annie, there's no easy way to say this, but I can't make it today." "What? What? But it's Saturday. We're supposed to be taking Tom to the Worm Charming Festival. He's so looking forward to it, and seeing you." "Annie, I'm really sorry. And you couldn't make it round here in the week either. That bloody surveillance operation you said you had to run." She was angry, very angry, his phone distorting with her firing words. Annie, I really am sorry, but I was trying to catch this rapist. And now we have got him. I have to question him today and charge him. What? It's the same thing all over again, isn't it? Your work coming before your family. Christ, it was bad enough with you not turning up in the week. But weekends? Haven't you got anyone else who works for the police force? Are you the only bloody one? He knew how much trouble he was in when he heard her swear, even such a mild word. Listen, Annie, I'll make it up to you and Tom, I will. I'll take a sort... Oh, yeah, you'll always make it up, won't you? That is, until something important comes up. Then you drop us, just like that. Annie, please, this is important. And we're not? Shit, why had he said that? No, no, of course, it's just that we're always the thing in your life that can give, aren't we? We're the expendable ones, always, your wife and your son. And just when I thought we were on the verge of getting back together and making it work... He'd felt his temper bite then, couldn't hold it. Well, maybe you should feel proud of me, eh? Has that occurred to you, that your husband has caught a man who is terrorising women in this bloody city, an evil bastard of a rapist, that he's got to interview him to make sure the case against him is watertight so he goes to prison for a long, long time? Maybe you should think of that. She'd cut the call and wouldn't answer when he'd rung back. Hadn't answered all morning, mobile off and no one at home. He hoped she'd taken Tom to the worm charming at Black Orton. Hoped, too, her anger had calmed and she'd been kind. Told him Dad was ill or had been called away. Not that he didn't care or other things were more important to him. Please, not that. Maybe she had a point. He was here at Charles Cross, wasn't he? Not in the quaint Devon village of Black Orton, buying ice creams, explaining to Tom about the mystic art of worm charming, holding Annie's hand, laughing with her at the contestants' bizarre antics. But it was the right decision. He knew it was. It had to be. It was his case. He was the senior officer, and it was up to him to make sure they did it right, that Godley couldn't be freed for a long time. He wanted to enjoy the man's face as he charged him with the rapes, wanted to see Godley led down to the cells. Suzanne and Claire could have handled it, but Godley was a woman-hater. Adam wondered if he would even talk to them. He had to be there, had no choice. But still he thought of Annie and Tom, watching those wonderful idiots pouring their potions into the ground or playing trumpets or singing into it in their ludicrous attempts to entice as many worms as possible from the safety of the warm and quiet earth. Sometimes a worm's life could seem so very appealing. They jogged down through the deer park towards the embankment. Dan couldn't stop his mind filling with hope that the answer could lie in Plymouth Road. He was prepared for disappointment after what had happened before, but he couldn't suppress that resurgent swell of excitement and anticipation. And anyway, what was there to lose? It was a beautiful day. He could do with a run, and Rutherford was enjoying his exercise. Checking out Els Hunch could just be a part of it. That was a good safety net for disappointment. The mud track they followed was dry, and flashes of bluebells lit the hedges as they ran past. A pair of magpies hopped across the rough tarmac of the road next to them, chattering to each other, circling, dancing, showing off their ink and white wings. A car slowed as it approached the birds, but they took no notice, went on with their embrace, oblivious. The driver hooted his horn, and they flapped off to the roof of a red brick house to continue their courtship. The mating season, Dan thought as he puffed up a gentle hill. Springtime and the world is feeling determinedly frisky, not interested in the impertinent distractions of cars and people. On the subject of which, what would he do about Claire now? She seemed keen to see him, and he wanted to see her. He could wait until next weekend. That would be the cool thing to do. But why wait? Follow the example of the magpies, perhaps, and flutter his wings. Take her for a drink this week? For dinner, even? He was a messy eater, though, wasn't he? That's what comes of living alone and heating up the fridge's contents rather than cooking. Maybe just a drink, then. Rutherford had found a fascination in a hedgerow, his head half buried in the leaves, his tail wagging fast, a black and brown blur in the spring air. Just as Dan was almost upon him, the dog yelped and jumped back, turned to his master, whimpering, jerking his head from side to side in spasms of pain. Oh, no, what's he done this time? Dan thought. Rutherford was a serial victim of curiosity-induced injury. In the last year, he'd managed to badly cut his nose on an old tin can and poke himself in the eye with a tree branch when chasing a stick. Both required expensive trips to the vet. It was worse than being a parent. At least with kids, you had the NHS. No such help for a stupid, disaster-prone dog. "Come here, boy, come here," Dan soothed and cupped the dog's head in his hands, checked his eyes, nose and mouth. Nothing obviously wrong, though his nose was dripping. He didn't seem to be in any real pain now. Maybe just the shock of a poke from a protruding stick. The hedgerow rustled furtively, and the dog looked round, but didn't plunge his nose back into the undergrowth. "So you do learn lessons, then," said Dan, trying not to chuckle, with the relief of finding Rutherford wasn't badly hurt. He leaned over carefully and looked into the grass and leaves, moved some aside with a tentative hand. A snarling fox? A growling cat, perhaps? A movement made him flinch back, but then he burst out laughing. Curled up at the bottom of the bank was a hedgehog, two black eyes peering suspiciously from within its ball of spines. "There's your conquering foe, you pathetic hound," he said. "Seen off by a hog, eh? I don't know, what use would you be against a burglar?" Dan knew exactly what had happened, had seen it before. The hog had got fed up with the dog sniffing at him and had sprung upwards, spiking Rutherford's nose. It was a shock, but nothing serious. "Come on then, you great warrior," he called to the dog, jogging on again. "Let's leave the victor in peace." They ran on down the hill and into a maze of streets. Dan stopped to check the map, wiped the sweat from his face with a sleeve. "Just on the left here," he thought. They turned a corner and came out into Plymouth Road. It was a long one, probably one of the city's earlier streets, busy until the dual carriageway embankment was built to usher the rushing traffic in and out of the city centre. There were houses down both sides, long lines of terraces. The River Plym sparkled behind, a ribbon of diamonds in the sunshine. The tide was low, black dots of birds pecking busily at the wizened mudflats. Dan put Rutherford back on his lead, and they walked along, counting down to number 225. His excitement was growing again. He couldn't help it. Hope was irrepressible. Maybe this time. Godley hadn't asked for a solicitor. A good sign, thought Adam. He wanted a confession, a signed statement. No need for a trial. He didn't want to see those women in the witness box, reliving their ordeal, listening to the defence counsel, suggesting they'd given Mr. Godley the come-on, that they'd lured him into doing what he did. Offensive, repellent, so hard to sit there quietly and take, but that was what they did. Godley couldn't very well deny he was the attacker. They had all the evidence they needed. But if he was the misogynist, Adam thought, he would enjoy his day in court, his one last triumph over his victims. He could delight in their distress, savour the wounds he'd inflicted. And there was always the chance the trauma would be too much for the women to continue with their testimony and the case would collapse. That had happened before, too many times. He couldn't risk it here. Most suspects they had in this interview room sat slumped over the table, looking defeated, sullen. Some sat upright, tense and angry, silently stiff with defiance. With a few, it was hard to stop them talking, so relieved were they to finally confess their crimes, a lancing of the toxins that had festered within them. Will Godley was none of those. He sat on the plastic chair, legs crossed, humming a tune, looking relaxed and writing a couple of notes on a piece of paper. Adam pressed the record button on the tape machine and sat down opposite him. Suzanne stayed standing by the door alongside a uniformed officer. "So, Mr. Godley, what have you got to tell us?" asked Adam, as neutrally as he could.
"I'll tell you exactly what I'll tell the jury," the man replied, calm and easy, looking Adam in the eye.
The look of a rapist, he thought. Authors would tell you the eyes were cold, emotionless and cruel, that you could see his crimes in them. They'd tell you the hardened detective shivered at the sight. Nothing like it. His eyes are perfectly normal, if anything, sparkling with amusement. The beautiful imaginings of his fists pummeling Godley's face roared back, ricocheted around his mind. He pushed them away, calmed himself, thought of the worm charming at Black Orton. It had become a family tradition for them to visit. The insanity was wonderful.
That man he saw last year, the one with the little drum kit, beating out an insistent rhythm on the earth, imploring the worms to come to him. The distraction blunted his anger and cleared his mind. Adam focused back on Godley's smug face. He knew he had to stay as calm as the detested man he was facing. "And what would that be then, Mr. Godley?" he asked. "What are you planning to tell the jury?" Number 225, semi-detached, next to a playground patch of hilly grass, covered in dry mud tracks and with a lopsided football goal at the far end. The house first, then. What was there about the house? A strange thought came to Dan of it being like something he used to draw at junior school. There were four windows, two up and two down, and a door in the middle with a crazy paved path leading up to it. It was whitewashed with a grey slate tiled roof, and there was nothing in any way remarkable about it. The garden was grassy with a few pink roses and other plants he didn't recognise, colouring the earth beds around its edges. It was absolutely ordinary. Dan stood back and again looked it up and down. Rutherford sat patiently at his feet, tail thumping on the ground. Still, nothing came to him. He looked through the notes and pictures he'd brought, crumpled now and with the odd trail of sweat sliding off them, but still clear. Could any of this refer to the house? Nothing in the numbers that he could see and nothing in the imagery, no matter how devious he encouraged his mind to be. Nothing at all. Try a hard-learned trick, then. Walk away for a bit, let the power of your subconscious chew it over, and see if it spits anything out. Let's try the playground. He kept Rutherford on the lead as there were kids about, and climbed up onto one of the grassy mounds. A couple of young lads wandered carefully over from the football goal. "Is this your dog, mister?" Tempting. Oh, so tempting. But it was a lovely day, and the kids were pleasant enough. No need for sarcasm. "Yes, he's mine, and no, he doesn't bite, so yes, you can stroke him." They looked at each other in amazement. "How did you know he was going to ask that?" Dan was going to tell the truth, that it's what every youngster asks. But why spoil the illusion of genius? He didn't get to experience it very often. "Because I can read minds," he said in his best mystic voice. "Cool." They weren't listening, were too busy rubbing Rutherford's head and patting his back. The dog tolerated it, as he did. Dan looked around again. Was there anything here that could possibly relate to any of the pictures? Could the paths in the play area resemble a snake? He knew it was hopeless, even as he thought of it. He couldn't see anything that could possibly be a clue. Oh, well, another futile attempt, he thought. But a pleasant run anyway, and at least my hangover's cleared. "Cheers, mister!" shouted the kids, running back to the goal. The goal. Could the goal be his goal? Tenuous, but worth a try. He followed them, stood watching the kickabout, dodged the odd badly directed shot, and knocked the ball back to them. Dan thought he made a nonchalant but thorough job of looking around the posts, but he couldn't see anything useful at all. Time to give up, jog back home, and have a shower. The sun and his sweat were a potent combination. Better get home before I start to smell. Then he saw it. The back garden of number 225, small and neat, and next to the bird table, a metal figure of a red-legged, red-beaked bird. A chough. His heart started up again, and Dan walked across to the wooden fence, looked over. Yes, it was certainly a chough, frozen as though hopping over the earth beneath it. Earth that looked like it had been disturbed recently. Had someone else found the answer, or was it evidence that it was buried here? He looked around. No one about. He could hear a radio playing in the house, so there was someone in. He couldn't very well hop over the fence and start digging, could he? Certainly not with Rutherford here to keep an eye on. So could someone have buried the answer here? Why not, if they did it at night? The garden was easy to get into. His heart was still pounding. So, how to check? He wasn't going home now without at least having a look. He didn't like to admit it, but this time the honest and obvious solution was going to have to be the one. Dan pulled Rutherford alongside and walked up the paved path. He stared at the door for a moment and then knocked. Adam sat still, breathed regularly, didn't fidget. He kept his eyes on Godley, stayed focused. From behind, he heard a scrape as Suzanne ran a shoe across the concrete floor, but he remained motionless, eyes locked on the man in front of him. "You see, Detective Inspector, I know women. I've always been good with women. I've always known what they're thinking." The man was talking easily, as if telling the story of a relaxing fishing trip he'd just returned from. "And I know what they want. Some women like playing a part, you see. I like playing a part myself. So when we get together, it can have very pleasant consequences, if you know what I mean." Godley smiled, knowing and understanding, one experienced man of the world to another. Again, that image screamed in Adam's mind, the fists he was clenching under the table beating into Godley's face, Sarah watching, nodding approvingly. "Calm it. Control it." "I'm not sure I do, sir." Neutral tone again, the best he could manage. "Please explain it to me." Godley's smile grew. He stretched out an arm on the table, spread his fingers, and yawned. "Then perhaps I have more experience of life than you, Chief Inspector." Godley paused, waited for a bite, but Adam stayed silent. "Some women like it rough, you see. Some women have the oddest fantasies, and they're more common than you think." He paused, scratched an ear with a well-trimmed nail. "And you know what one of the most common is?" Again, that image, Adam's fists pounding into the man's face. "Push it away. Calm. Control." "I'm afraid I don't," he managed. "Do, please, tell me." "Well, it's like this," Godley continued smoothly. "And don't be shocked here, Chief Inspector. I was a little when I first found out, but you get used to it. I came to enjoy it, in fact. I was glad to help them." Again he smiled, waited for a reaction. Still, the detective remained impassive. Godley nodded gently, then spoke. "Some women have this fantasy about sex with a stranger, you see. And not just as simple as that. Oh no, nothing quite so easy. They like a little bit of security to go with the excitement, so they want to do it in their own homes. And you know what makes them even more excited? If they pretend to themselves they don't know the man's coming and he has to break in to get to them. Oh, they just love that. It really gets them going. Oh, it gets them going so much." Again the smile, again a pause, waiting for the reaction that Adam knew he couldn't give. Godley leaned forward across the table and dropped his voice, a whispered confidence between old friends. "And you know what they like most of all? The icing on the cake, as it were. They like to pretend they didn't arrange it all, that they didn't want to do it, that they were forced to. And then they like to get the police involved, to give their little fantasy that delicious added reality." Godley sat back on his chair. He crossed his legs again and beamed at Adam. "Strange, isn't it? But it's true, so very true. And I help them with it." A balding man in his mid-30s opened the door. He was wearing a green Plymouth Argyle football shirt and tracksuit bottoms flecked with white paint. "Yeah?" he said suspiciously, looking from Dan to Rutherford. "Can I help you?" For once in his life, Dan was at a loss to explain what he wanted. "Yeah," he said, but was interrupted by a peroxide blonde older woman joining the man at the door. "Yeah," she exclaimed. "Are you that guy off the telly?" An opening, Dan thought. Being recognised could be useful for once. "Yes, yes, I am, yes." "Well, come in. Bill, don't keep guests waiting on the doorstep. I've told you about that before. And yes, bring your dog in too. We love animals." Dan was ushered into a kitchen, which looked out over the garden, and was given a cup of tea. It was old-fashioned, but tidy and clean. An African grey parrot sat on a perch in a silver cage on top of the fridge. It eyed them balefully. 1-0 to the Argyle, it squawked and cackled. Dan tried not to stare. "Quiet, Jake," the woman said. "So, what do we owe this honour to?" she asked, as Dan blew steam from his tea. "Are you going to put us on the TV?" She was doing all the work here, he thought. "You know, I just might," he replied. "It rather depends. May I ask you an odd question?" Well, they both nodded. "Has anyone come knocking at your door, asking to dig up part of your garden?" From their obvious bafflement, Dan knew he was the first. Another kick of adrenaline hit him. They stood in the garden, beside the chuff, Dan and Bill, both with spades in their hands. He'd explained. They'd grown excited, then businesslike. After some bartering, they'd reached a deal. If the answer was here, they'd be interviewed for the TV news and get £5,000. The one thing that was worrying him was whether someone had beaten him to it. Bill and his mum said no one had come asking to dig up the garden, but what if it had happened at night? The earth looked like it had been disturbed, but Bill said he'd probably done that when he was gardening. First Dan checked the chaff. Nothing, not a hint of a clue. Then they started digging up the ground beneath it, each shifting a spadeful of earth at a time. If there was something important here, he didn't want to damage it. It was only a couple of minutes' work before there was a dull, metallic clank, and Bill's spade stopped abruptly in the earth. He'd hit something. "Shit," he hissed, falling to his knees, scrabbling the soil away. Dan watched, stroking Rutherford's head, tried to contain his excitement. He thought back to Advent and then the manhole cover, tried to prepare himself for disappointment, but couldn't resist kneeling down to look. They'd uncovered a small metal box, the size of a biscuit tin. It was covered with faded flowers. Bluebells, Dan thought with a shock. Bluebells, as in Bluebella. This had to be it. Bill pulled the tin from the ground, shook off the loose soil and stared at it. He went to lift the lid, but his mother slapped his arm. "He should open it," she said in a tone which allowed no argument. Dan was annoyed to see his fingers trembling as he reached for the lid. He found an edge and lifted it. It opened easily. Inside was a piece of paper. "£5,000. Come on, £5,000, Bill repeated in a hushed voice. "£5,000. Dan unfolded the paper. There were some words, handwritten, McCluskey's writing again. He recognised it now. This time. Surely this time. It had to be. "Come on, stop shaking fingers. Give me a chance to read it." His throat had gone dry. He turned the paper around. What did it say? "Not here either." Adam was amazed at how level he managed to keep his voice. "So you're going to tell the jury that these women secretly wanted you to come round and have sex with them, then tried to cover it up afterwards by saying it was rape, and that they added to their fantasies by calling the police in?" "That's it," Godley replied warmly. Despite all three giving a sworn statement saying they were attacked and raped in their homes by a man unknown to them, despite all three of them being willing to testify to that in court?
"Well, they would say that, wouldn't they? You know what women are like. They'll say anything to get themselves out of trouble. They just want to make themselves look good."
Adam didn't rise to it, knew what Godley wanted. "No jury in the world will believe you."
"Well, we'll have to see, won't we? It'll be an interesting trial. I'm certainly looking forward to it."
Godley rolled a cigarette, beamed that infuriating smile. "I'm planning to defend myself, you know," he went on chattily. "I'm sure the ladies will be excited to see me again. I'll be close to them too, just a few feet away. Probably close enough for them to smell me, just like they did before. I'll be able to ask them all about what it was like when we had our little moment of ecstasy together."
Godley tapped the cigarette on the table, tilted his head. "The one thing I haven't decided yet is what to wear. I think it'll have to be the same clothes I had on when I popped round to see the ladies. I'm sure that little touch will excite them even more."
It took all of Adam's self-control not to blaze his fist into that smug, leering face. His mind ran to the trial. Godley would be convicted. Yes, of course he would. But that would be little consolation when the women broke down in court, when they collapsed and sobbed and screamed in front of the judge, barristers and jury and the packed public gallery, Godley himself watching with that smile on his face, not to mention the risk of the trial collapsing. There must be some way to shake him up, get to him, make him admit to his crimes. Adam breathed deeply. "Mr. Godley, I'm going to outline the evidence against you one more time, just to see if it makes any difference to what you've told us." Godley smiled again, opened his arms in a friendly way.
"Go ahead. I love hearing it and the spin you put on it."
Adam gritted his teeth. "These three women were attacked in their own homes by a man they didn't know and had never met. Attacked and raped. Your DNA matches the samples we've taken, so it was you. You don't contest that?"
"Not at all. I wouldn't dream of contesting it. I'm here to tell you the truth, Inspector. It was me doing what they wanted. I think all the evidence tallies It just depends on which way you look at it to see what story it tells.
And you made this arrangement with them when?
Oh, when I met them in town or in a bar. That was part of it, you see. They wanted the element of surprise. They didn't want to know when I was coming. They gave me their addresses, told me they were alone in the house and would love to see me. More than love, in some cases. The timing was up to me, you see. It was much more of a thrill for them that way.
Adam stared into the man's eyes. They say that's rubbish, he growled.
Well, it's just my word against theirs, isn't it? We'll have to see what the jury think. I'll be surprised if they don't see it my way, especially if there are plenty of men on there. I'm sure that's what I'll be looking for. A jury nice and full of men. I only need three to understand, and I can't be convicted, eh? There aren't many men who haven't suffered at a woman's hands, are there? Have you, Inspector?
That image again, his fists pounding Godley's face, the hard heels of his leather shoes stamping on it, grinding.
I think you followed them home, hissed Adam. You checked the place out to make sure there was no man around, then you came back and struck.
He couldn't resist it, had controlled himself for too long. Just like the coward you are, Mr. Godley, the pathetic, inadequate coward.
Godley's smile didn't flicker. He shook his head, but sadly now, as if indulging an idiot.
I'm shocked you could think that. Shocked? Have you suffered at a woman's hands, Inspector? I'm getting that feeling from you.
Adam ignored the bait. I think you hate women because your wife left and took the kids, he said. I think all this was your attempt at revenge.
Officer, really?
Godley sounded amazed. That's absolute conjecture on your part. I can still see my kids when I can, the court's permitting, of course. And as for revenge, it never crossed my mind. I was just doing what the women wanted, providing a service, if you like.
Was there any point in going on with this? Adam thought. Godley was going to stick by his story. He was determined to have his day in court. But he would go down. Hold on to that. The man was going to prison for many long years.
What about those witches' hats? Adam asked. They're clear evidence about what you think of women.
Godley shook his head, the smile still fixed.
Not at all, Chief Inspector. You're reading that all wrong. The ladies told me they longed to reveal their dark sides, and they wanted me to leave them a souvenir when I'd gone. They wanted something to remind them of such a wonderful experience, they said.
Behind him, a sharp breath from Suzanne. This was pointless. The man was set on his story and would force them to go to trial.
That was. Unless.
Just one idea. One chance. Nothing he should be doing. But he'd broken the rules on this one already, hadn't he? Several times. And before, on those two other rape cases. Once more wouldn't hurt. Adam turned to the door.
Suzanne, would you mind getting me a coffee, please? And John, would you help her? You know what those stairs can be like.
Suzanne stared at him for a moment, then nodded silently and left. The uniformed officer followed behind her. The heavy door clunked shut.
Interview suspended, 12:20 p.m. for a refreshment break, Adam said, and reached out, stopped the tape. He saw Godley stiffen, his eyes widened.
He thinks he's going to get a beating, Adam thought. Tempting, so tempting, but no, nothing so obvious. But there's no harm keeping it in his mind. He stood up, walked over to the whitewashed brick wall behind Godley, making the man shift uneasily in his chair and crane his neck to look around.
Right then, Adam spat. There's one thing we haven't talked about, which I'm going to mention now. Prison.
That's if. Forget that crap. This is between you and me now.
Godley turned on his chair, faced Adam, but didn't get up.
We both know you're going down. I'll be amazed if the jury even have to retire before they bring in the guilty verdict. You just want to have your final sick bit of fun in court.
I resent that. I'm an innocent man.
Adam strode across to the table, slammed his fist down on it.
He leaned over, his face an inch from Godley's. He could smell the cigarettes, just as the man's victims had.
There's one more twist, Godley, and it's this. I'm going to give you a chance, which is more than you deserve, a lot more.
The man looked at him, silent at last.
You're going to have a rough time in prison as it is. You know how sex attackers get treated in there.
Godley didn't react, kept his eyes on Adam's.
There's only one type of person who gets it worse inside than a rapist, Godley. Do you know who that is?
Tell me.
The words were heavy with contempt, but he was listening.
At least he was listening. That sickening smile had finally faded. Paedophiles, Godley. Kiddie fiddlers. You know what happens to them inside, don't you? They're lucky to get out alive. Godley sprung up from his chair. I'm not a... Adam grabbed his shoulder, pushed him back down hard, enjoyed the feeling of the man's body giving under the force. The only thing that saves them is the watchfulness of the warders, hissed Adam, his mouth next to Godley's ear. But they're only human. They have lapses. They can't be everywhere all the time, especially when they get word from someone outside that it's time to have a lapse. Godley glared at him, but didn't try to get up again. What are you saying, you bastard? He was scared now, and Adam sensed it. Sweet fear. He relished it. What I'm saying is this, Godley. Your neighbours already think you're a pedo. Isn't that what they wrote on your wall? Well, that's a good start. So when it comes to court, all it needs is for the detective chief inspector in charge of the case to voice his belief that you aren't just a rapist, but a paedophile too. Godley snarled at him, but his face had changed colour. He turned pale. Fuck off! You wouldn't! You bastard! Fuck off! What else you'll say, Mr. Godley, is this. Adam straightened up, breathed out slowly. He stared at the tiny window of the interview room as though rehearsing his words for the witness box. I shall say that it's too much of a coincidence for me that there were young children in the houses you broke into. I shall have to tell the jury and the judge and all those reporters in the press gallery that I suspect you had it in mind to sexually abuse them too, but were frightened off before you could do so. It won't take long for that to get into the papers and around that lovely prison you'll be heading off to. Godley stared up at him, his face tight and twisted with hate. You bastard! I'm not the rapist here, Godley, spat back Adam. Now, are you going to reconsider the statement you've given us, or shall we call it a day and get you back to the cells so you can have a nice bit of peace and quiet to think about what's going to happen to you in prison? Dan was on his knees, sliding the box containing the death pictures, prints and his notes back under his bed when his mobile rang. He shuffled backwards to get it and banged his head on the wooden bed frame. Ouch! He yelped. Bloody hell, McCluskey, isn't it about time you stopped tormenting me? The phone was on the table in the hallway. He grabbed it before the answer machine kicked in. Adam. Afternoon, mate. How you doing? Dan said, rubbing his head. Good, thanks. Very good. In the background came the sound of a trumpet playing, very out of tune. What the hell's that? Dan asked. A chuckle on the line. That is a man playing a trumpet at the ground, trying to charm some worms out of it. Black Orton. Spot on. You've been? I went a couple of years ago, but found it so weird I had to get pissed to watch. It didn't help mine. It was still very strange. I'm down here with Annie and Tom. Dan heard the relief in his friend's voice. Going well? He asked. Much better, thanks, yes. Listen, this is just a quick call. I've nipped away for a minute to get some ice creams. You know how much Annie likes me thinking about work when I'm with her. Sure, carry on. You should know, we've charged a man with the rapes in Plymouth. What? Dan almost dropped the phone. He jogged quickly into the lounge, grabbed a pen and some paper. So that was what Claire was talking about. It's one of the main suspects, Will Godley, continued Adam. He's confessed to the crimes, so I don't think there'll be a trial, but obviously don't put too much detail into whatever you broadcast. Dan thought his way through the law. I don't think we'll be able to do much more than report the charge, Adam, just in case he changes his mind about the confession and it does come to trial. We can't risk prejudicing it, but thanks for the tip-off anyway, and well done. That's a hell of a good result. I'll call the newsroom and we'll get it on air. Plymouth will breathe a big sigh of relief. Now go celebrate. Have fun with the worms. Will do. Oh, Dan, just one thing. Any luck with the death pictures riddle? Annie's really interested in it. Don't ask. Just don't ask.